Thank you, of course, for seeing the last stretch. This afternoon, we'll start the series on the vision, because in the past years, you've seen that the regional support plays a big role in the management academic practice. I'll start off with the vision management and patients with chronic disease. If you look at the prevalence of protein calorie malnutrition in patients with liver disease, usually it's rare in patients with acute liver disease. But in patients with cirrhotics, the prevalence go about 20%. More so if you have decompensated cirrhotics. When you say decompensated cirrhotics, we're speaking of cirrhotics possibly with diabetes, with esophageal dialysis. The prevalence goes up about 65 to 90%. And if you have a cirrhotic waiting for liver transplantation, 100% of this patient most likely have malnutrition. And there's a direct correlation between the severity of liver disease and the severity of malnutrition. What does that mean? When you have a malnourished cirrhotic, then there's increased morbidity. They're twice likely to have refractory ascites. For patients, for example, who have a malnutrition, they have higher rates of going into hepatic encephalopathy, infection, and various diseases. There's a question on whether there's increased mortality because of the malnutrition per se, or because actually the severity. So, what are your goals if you have a patient with cirrhotic? You want to prevent or correct the malnutrition, and if possible, support hepatic regeneration. Treat the complications, all of this, of course, with the goal that you have improved survival, because now you have improved survival outcome, liver function, and less complications to deal with. The learning objectives for this session will be, one, I'd like to review the functions of the liver, review the nutritional features of a patient with cirrhosis, and thereafter, of course, discuss the nutritional management of a patient with cirrhosis. And then the breakdown of the fibrous glycogen. The pulse is involved in the formation of glucose from other substances or substrates, and it converts galactose and fructose into glucose. In terms of protein metabolism, it performs transamination and deamination. The ammonia that you get is converted to urea. It's involved, of course, in the formation of serum proteins and lipoproteins. In terms of fat metabolism, it converts free fatty acids to acetyl-CoA, and then acetyl-CoA goes in, and then you can either oxidize, and then again, become byproducts for your glucose production. Okay? Involved in ketogenesis and synthesis, likewise, bile production. It's involved, as I mentioned earlier, in vitamin and mineral metabolism. It's a storage site for your fat-soluble vitamins and vitamin B12. It stores, likewise, iron, copper, zinc, and manganese. It's involved in activation of some of your vitamins. And likewise, it synthesizes or produces carrier proteins for vitamins A and B12, and lipoproteins that prevent the needle transport to vitamin E. So, if you have a patient with liver disease, there are a lot of things that could happen. You can have alcohol, fatty liver, viruses, toxins. All of these may cause inflammation and subsequently fibrosis in this liver. Eventually, if you have such an insult, this patient has cirrhosis and even HCC or hepatoma. What happens when you have a patient with cirrhosis? The liver is now not able to do its function. So, you have disturbed glucose supply during fasting. Your liver won't have enough glycogen, so there's increased glucose. And this is, it's going to act like starvation. You have increased utilization of your lipids and your proteins to form glucose. Now, This increase, of course, production of ammonia and decreased protein synthesis. And the other thing you notice in patients with cirrhosis is this preferred oxidation of your branch chain amino acids. For your fat, fat is the preferred, will become the preferred fuel. And this increased nocturnal fat metabolism increased glycolysis at a short-term batch, not to mention impaired synthesis of your PUFA from your free fatty acids. So, you have a patient with features of protein energy malnutrition, low serum protein, vitamin deficiencies, and even mineral deficiencies. In a patient, you have already altered metabolism, but there are other things that can contribute to the patient having malnutrition in a patient with chronic kidney disease. You can have poor oral intake, we mentioned altered metabolism, malabsorption, and decreased storage capacity. Why would this patient have poor oral intake? Well, they have some walang gana, okay, anorexia, partly from increased TNF, or not to mention altered taste because of zinc deficiency. You can have a patient who has ascites, therefore some early satiety there. For example, I had a patient, each time you do parasites, sumagana. When it accumulates, wala na naman siyang gana. You have patients who might have low-grade encephalopathy, or we might be causing acid with a poor oral intake. Usually, when they come in, might place them on NPO, not to mention, sarami minsan, nasabi natin, bawal po, wala nang nakakain pa siya. Malabsorption. You have liver diseases, for example, where you can have, especially cholestatic liver diseases, where you can have malabsorption, not to mention bile salt deficiency and small bacterial overgrowth. Medications you give, like neomycin or cholestyramine, might also contribute to your malabsorption. We've mentioned, so we'll keep this, what is metabolic disturbance. So when you're having a patient who is malnourished, the first thing you do when you're doing nutritional support is, of course, assess the nutritional status of this patient. So, it's a recommendation, of course, that all cirrhotics should undergo nutritional assessment. However, one thing you might have to remember is accurate measurement of nutritional status might not be readily done. For example, body weight, you can't really reliably use this because your patients might have ascites. The other thing, using albumin or pre-albumin for that matter, we don't know whether the low albumin is from malnutrition or secondary to the patient's liver dysfunction. So what can you use? You can use, of course, your subjective global assessment. Okay. This is sort of a questionnaire. It tells you weight, how much you've eaten, all these facts. The nice thing about this is slow. It's a bit reliable in that it's not affected by fluid retention or ascites. The other thing, though, is it might underestimate the presence of malnutrition in your cirrhotic patient. And of course, this is something you cannot use, for example, in patients who have FNCF and can't answer it. So, the other sophisticated methods, don't speak in terms of they're not that readily available. So, what can you use? Functional assessment of your muscle strength, probably using an angiopathometer. It has been shown that it's a good predictor of complications in end-stage liver disease. Somehow, this will correlate with your total body protein scores. And it's a sensitive marker for indicating depletion of your body cell mass. If you compare SGA with hand grip, it looks like hand grip thermometry might be a better case, in at least a your patients with malnutrition, in patients with cirrhosis. As enlarged, because obviously you won't be able to see. This is a nutrition prioritizing tool. Go through the steps, and somehow to end, you're going to get a score, and gives you more or less an idea of what to do. So first, to ask yourself, does the patient have alcoholic hepatitis, or are they being treated? If yes, you give them score 6. If no, you give them score 0. Then, next, you ask yourself if there are signs of fluid overload, like the presence of peripheral edema or ascites. The red is if your answer is a no, then you check in terms of BMI, there's unexplained weight loss, is the patient contributing or not. If your answer on the other hand for step 2 is a yes, then what you assess will be, again, you look if there's weight loss, dietary intake, and if there's presence of your fluid overload, which might interfere with the patient's ability. And then a score of 0, just to be screening, routine clinical care. If you have 1, you have routine clinical care, but you start monitoring food drugs. Okay? And of course, you encourage your patient to eat more. But if you have a score of 2 to 7, then you might have to refer this patient to a dietitian. And of course, this means closer monitoring of your patient. Now you've assessed more or less what you're going to do with your patient. Okay? Question is, how much calories are you going to give and how do you give it on the route? Okay? This is the ESTEN guidelines. For patients with compensated cirrhosis, you give at least 25 to 35 kilocalories per kilogram per body weight and a protein of 1 to 1.5. For decompensated cirrhosis, you give even more kilocalories. 35 to 40, and a protein of 1.5 grams per kilogram. What do you know? A high caloric diet for these patients. Why? Because you want to give them enough calories so that they do not break down the food. The other thing you should note in this table is that wala na yung protein restriction. We do not protein restrict our patients. Okay? For hepatic cancer, grade 1 or 2. You might decrease your protein intake in HEP cancer, grade 3 or 4, but you should increase it eventually as the patient recovers. Okay? So, hindi na uso yung zero protein. Okay? Now, if you have patients with ascites, then you have to have correction. So, you usually base it on dry weight. Okay? So, for minimal serious ascites, you might have to remove from 1 to 2.2, so sort of correct the weight, a kilogram body weight, depending on how you assess the hepatitis for the woman. This is what I mentioned when there was a study that shows you why you do not restrict your dietary protein. There were 30 malnourished cirrhotics with HEP and CEP stage 2. Group A was given 0 gram protein and then increased incrementally over the next phase. The other group was given 1.2 gram protein per kilogram per day. And of course, both of them received sweet therapy, lactose, and oral minimizing. What was the outcome? Restricting protein does not have any positive effect on the evolution of your hepatic encephalopathy. So no change here. But when you compare group 1, group A, group 2, you note that there's increased breakdown in the group where you restricted your proteins. So, that's one of the reasons why you do not protein restrict your patients, even though you have hepatitis here. Another thing to remember, we mentioned earlier, in patients with cirrhosis, you have, well, the decreased glucose first. There's decreased glycogen scores. So that this patient, in short class, not a glucose like that. So what happens? It will break down in the class to produce the glucose. So there's increased gluconeogenesis, increased muscle glycogenolysis, increase of the breakdown of free fatty acid oxidation, and even gluconeogenesis. So you want to prevent long periods of fasting. So, what do we recommend? 4 to 6 small portion size meals. The idea is to distribute the protein and the sugars throughout the day, and of course to prevent this fasting period. Very important actually to remember, give your patient bedtime or late evening snacks. So give them forgiveness now. In the hospital setting, where you're thinking of sending the patient, or you're going to pass the station for them, change your fluids to a D5 containing fluid. When we speak of late evening snacks, what we would recommend would be to give 50 grams of carbohydrate snacks. Actually, we can give proteins and carbohydrates. And this would translate to one. Tell them, I'm fine on snacks, breakfast cereals with milk in the evening. You can eat jam, milk, and biscuits, okay? Just ask them, you tell the relative, you need to feed this patient at night. If, for example, you've noticed that this patient kulang, I mean, it's not eating enough, then yeah, you can initiate NAD or enteral nutrition treatment. Okay. We usually will use standard energy dense formula. You can certainly deliver it with nasal enteral tube. And same thing, when you have nasal enteral TB, aspiration precautions. In a patient with cirrhotic, who has ascites, this is a patient, of course, we will refuse to insert that day because of this. Taste the hole where it won't be able to get from the fistula breathing specific fluid. For patients who have an NGP, if you're still not able to deliver enough calories, let's say they always have received one. The these are the patients, yes, you might have to start parenteral nutrition. And what you have to remember if you start these patients on parenteral nutrition is to monitor their glucose closely. Okay. If hyperglycemia develops, then you limit your glucose to 2 to 3 grams per kilogram per day. Lipids will also need to be less than 1 gram per kilogram per day. Because manganese and copper are stored in your liver, in the setting especially of polycystic liver disease, you have to limit the manganese and the copper in your kidney. Concentrate your solution, and what you want when you say cyclical regimen, we need to say there are there are times when you get off. Okay, you need to look at the continuous TPN to be given. There's less risk of this patient developing hepatic cirrhosis. That's the type of protein matter, if you're giving oral food, for example. Well, one would say the recommendations would be deep vegetable protein. Why? Well, they contain more dietary fiber, so it's a prebiotic, it's resistant, and there's more ammonia detoxification. Vegetable proteins will have low aromatic amino acids, methionine, and cysteine. Why is this important? Because they're believed to be involved in your false neurotransmitters formation. Okay. And vegetable protein will have high ornithine and arginine content. So increase. Okay, so there's increased increase deamination. Results of the clinical studies, however, show it's less convincing. How about giving your branched chain amino acids, which will include your dating, leucine, and isoleucine? The important thing with branched chain amino acids, unlike your aromatic amino acids, they're metabolized, okay, more than your skeletal muscle. And if you look at this, branched chain amino acids goes into your PCA. Part of them will go to your muscles. Your alpha glutamate goes into your glutamate. Your glutamate becomes your glutamate, thereby fracturing. So, in patients with cirrhosis, actually, there's decrease. There's increases in your BCAA, so that you notice that if they measure, for example, fissure ratio. Fissure ratio is actually your ratio between your branched chain amino acids and your aromatic amino acids. It's decreased, okay, in patients with cirrhotic. And this is associated with decreased cancer. But essentially, as I mentioned earlier, in hepatic NSAID, supposedly there's decreased BCAA levels, increase in your aromatic amino acid levels, increase your phenylalanine, tyrosine, and methionine. And these all means that you might have increased both neurotransmitters and serotonin, which can now contribute to hepatic cell. When you look, however, at studies, partly I think because you have a high dropout rate. When your patient is taking branched chain amino acids, partly because now, three targets of your BCAA supplementation in chronic liver disease. It can, as I mentioned earlier, prevent or treat hepatic MCI, repair and regenerate an injured liver, and prevent and treat hepatic infection. Let's go over about hepatic regeneration. What we know is that mucin, for example, will stimulate your cells to produce your hepatic growth factor, and therefore you have increased hepatocyte formation. Furthermore, it will stimulate the mTOR pathways, and as a result of that, your hepatocytes will produce more albumin. So, BCAA in cirrhosis, probably especially if you have patients with chronic NSAID or patients with frequent hospital admissions. If you have depletion of fat muscles, then these are the patients you should consider giving branched chain amino acids. Definitely, you do not want to supplement glutamine in your diet because glutamine will be just broken down to glutamate and ammonia. You don't like to increase ammonia. So do you need to give vitamins, a two-week course of soluble vitamins in patients with decompensated cirrhosis is justifiable. IV thiamine supplementation, especially if you have patients with Wernicke's or alcohol enzyme. For fat-soluble vitamins, you give it especially if you have patients with cholestasis. Vitamin D, that's an important, Gaucher dystrophy is an important symptom, for example, that might be seen in patients with cirrhosis. And especially with patients with PBC, primary biliary cirrhosis, or sclerosing cholangitis, irrespective of stage, then you give this patient calcium and vitamins. And another thing is to encourage this patient to drink milk and daily. Manganese you want to avoid, and iron, yeah, if you have patients with hemochromatosis, something that you increase, of course, iron and vitamins is the medication of this patient. Zinc has been. There's some study that zinc deficiency is implicated in hep and death. So one would say yes, you can probably supplement zinc for about 2 weeks, then discontinue. Patients with ascites might have poor oral intake, hypervolemic and hypoglycemia. These are the patients who want to sodium restrict their sodium. And do you fluid restrict these patients? No, not until their sodium is about 120. Patients with banding, there's no contraindication for use of certain NGP and kidney patients. Summarize. Okay. Patients with malnutrition are common in chronic liver disease. Pathogenesis is multifactorial, and you want to identify and treat it early. This is more or less a repetition. All patients undergo no assessment. The optimal energy intake is about 35 to 40. Optimal protein, 1.2 to 1.5 grams per kilogram. I guess what's important, after all is said, is done. Whenever there's one message I want to get to you, do not restrict your dietary protein and give your patient 18 minutes.